Sports. Nebraska's home for sports is at Sun Valley Lanes in Lincoln, Nebraska for the 2012 Nebraska High School Bowling Federation Boys State Championships. And hello again, everyone. Along with Steve Simpak, I'm Larry Putney. Great to have you with us back here at Sun Valley Lanes for another year of high school bowling. We will crown four state champs this morning in classes A, B, C, and D. We begin this morning in Class D, where Humphrey St. Francis back here once again and once again looking for a state title.
And they bring a big crowd from Humphrey when they come down and root their team on, looking for that back-to-back.
Should be a good one in Class B as the Pius X Thunderbolts take on York. Thunderbolts have had some success here as of late.
Looking for three championships on the last 4 years, Larry. It'll be another great match, a lot of high scores, great bowlers in this upcoming Class B match.
In for a treat later today, the final match of the day in Class A. Columbus Discoverers back here once again, and this is a team that is loaded with talent.
We'll have a freshman that averages almost 220 on the lanes for you to see. Yeah. Wait till you see this spectacle. It will be great, great shot making.
Columbus Discoverers looking for back-to-back state champs. We'll have it all this morning for you right here on NET Sports, beginning in Class D. State championship coming your way. Humphrey St. Francis taking on Alma. We'll be right back.
Brought to you in part by the Ellen and Marcia Bear Foundation and by the Nebraska High School Bowling Federation, encouraging high schools to sanction the sport of bowling across Nebraska.
Animal agriculture is vital to Nebraska. Livestock production not only contributes to our food supply, but also helps our rural communities. Livestock provides revenue for schools, creates jobs, supports Main Street, and enhances the future for farm families. The Nebraska Soybean Board's Animal Agriculture Initiative works to encourage growth of responsible livestock enterprises to benefit agriculture and Nebraska.
Power Drive Electric Car Program gives high school students a hands-on way to apply studies, learn about electricity and energy efficiency, and develop skills that will benefit them throughout their lives. Nebraska Public Power District encourages students and teachers to get involved. Schools have the power to make it happen. For information on Power Drive, visit oppd.com or nppd.com.
Sunday morning at 8 Central Time on NET1.
In Lincoln, Nebraska, along with Steve Simpak, I'm Larry Putt. I want to remind you, a great way to preserve these memories for a lifetime is to get a DVD of these Nebraska High School Bowling Federation State Championships. You can pick that up at nhsbf.com. Log on, click through the links, and order your DVD copy. Alma and Humphrey St. Francis start off the morning in Class D. Let's take a look at the starting lineups. We'll begin with the Flyers from Humphrey St. Francis. Brandon Vike is a sophomore. Chad Heyer is a freshman. Junior Evan Eicher, the senior Lynn Slama, sophomore Caden Wimhoff, Robbie Brockhouse is a freshman, and Jacob Mosbach is a senior for the Flyers. Taking a look at the Alma Cardinals, head coach Chris Mihalik, assisted by Rich Soderholm. Brett Jansen is a senior. Levi Kindler is a senior. Luke Davis, the junior. Nick Davis, a junior, and Ryan Soderholm is leading the way, averaging 195 in his freshman year for the Alma Cardinals. St. Francis undefeated on the season. Those young men right there put together a perfect 9-0 record in districts, averaged 629. And they're taking on Alma, the Cardinals, for a state championship. They had the high district game. They had the high district series. So would be considered the favorites. Head coach Corey Hostreiter and the St. Francis Flyers. So the two coaches will get the teams together. Once again, a reminder, the way high school bowling works in Nebraska and really many places around the country is you have qualifying games, so all these teams bowled qualifiers to get here yesterday. Then you put it into a stepladder bracket final. The top eight teams go into the bracket, 1 versus 8, 2 versus 7, and so on, and they bowl a best of five Baker format. Right off the bat, strike on the left-hand lane for Humphrey St. Francis and Evan Eicher. Up on the right-hand lane, here's Luke Davis, the junior, averaging 158 on the year. Luke trying to answer, and he does. Good way to get started here in this Class D state championship. First Saturday or Sunday of state championships on NET. Coming up next weekend, we'll have the girls' state championships for you. Looking for the double. Chad Heyer can't get the mixer to go. Up on the right-hand lane, here's Ryan Soderholm. Ryan, just a freshman, and he likes to tug on it a little bit and slides it a little bit high. Double pinochle. 4-6-7-10.
Seeing a lot of contemporary styles, a lot of hook, a lot of hand, wrist, and arm into the ball. But
just slides by the 4-7.
We take that hand and wrist out of the ball to pick up the spares sometimes. So cross lane at the big four. Ryan's just going to shoot for two. Be happy with two and take the count. You'll see here is a lot of the players playing around the second arrow area of the lane. That's what we call the track area here in bowling. Majority of the players do play right around that second, between the second and the third arrow. You'll see many of the players play in that area. First no-thumb bowler we've seen in some time, Larry.
Brandon Vike now up on the left-hand lane. Vike will try to convert that spare that was just missed, and that's going to slide, but he got it. Gets that four pin to kick into the seven and picks up the spare for the Flyers. Up on the right-hand lane now. Here's Brent Jansen. Brent, no thumb in that ball. Get a little more hook and picks up the spare.
It's the style of today. Anybody that watches the Professional Bowlers Tour on television, on national TV, you'll notice how many more players there are out now that use no thumb, try to get maximum amount of pin action, revolutions, hook, anything to store power for those pins in the pocket.
So here's Levi Kindler. Kindler leaves the 1-2-8. A little sleeper back there up on the left-hand lane now. Robbie Brockhaus. Brockhaus just a freshman and a lefty. Tugging a little. So that opens the door a bit for Alma and Kindler for the conversion. Kindler can pick this up. They'll open up that lead, and he gets that head pin. Drives straight back into the eight and got it. Almost as if he knew it as he walked back to the bench. He might have been the only one around it. Crossover and another strike by Lynn Slama. So Slama, two shots, two strikes. So this is easy on TV.
Yep. No pressure.
Luke Davis saw it at the line, gets the roll, and gets the 7-10 and out.
Coming up in your sixth frame, Larry, is your anchor bowlers. That is your one of two bowlers that get to shoot two frames in Baker bowling. They bowl the second, the sixth, and the tenth. So these are your go-to players. These are the players you're going to get when you or get it, would like to have up there when you're in need of a strike.
Chad Heyer gets him all to go on the mixer. On the left-hand lane, here's the freshman, Soderholm. Soderholm maybe needs to get a little deeper. He's twice in a row come up a little high. Maybe a almost there. It's a 3-2 or a 5-3 move left.
Looks a little fast on the approach. Feet get a little quick. Set that ball down a little early. cross lane at the 3 and the 6, or excuse me, at the 5 and the 9, that is.
Sometimes here on TV, too, it may be less about not playing the right part of the lane, but maybe just a little nerves. You know? Some nerves tugging it a little bit. Maybe just playing the right part of the lane, just not delivering it to the right spot.
It's a very, very, very fast approach. It's a lot of times you get up there ahead of your arm swing. You have to pull your arm across your body to get the ball back.
So a quick score check. St. Francis had the lead prior to that opener. And now a tough 7-9 split for Alma to try to convert. And we are going to be just about even heading into the eighth frame. Maybe one pin differential, if anything. Gets that 7-pin off of the 2-7. Throw that backup ball at it. He comes out of that all different kind of ways, doesn't he, without that thumb in there. So we are one pin differential through 7. 100 for Alma, 99 for St. Francis. Important first game, best of 5 Baker format. And a good conversion. Important spare for St. Francis. And now to answer, here's Kindler. Kindler crosses it over, nearly trips the 6. Get up on the right-hand lane. Here is Lynn Slama. Slama has struck his 2 previous times, crosses over. Not quite that time, leaves the 6-10.
Low maintenance game, right down the middle, not a lot of hook. A lot of varying styles here you're gonna see in this match.
And a good conversion by Kindler on the left-hand lane.
So, as you said, Larry, very close. Spare here will keep it within about 10 pins.
St. Francis. Slama just slid it by on the right-hand side. So that might open the door here for Alma. Now, Alma needs good count here to retain the lead through 8. But with that open in the 9th, the mark here gives them a 10-pin-plus lead. That'll do it. So a big shot in the 9th frame.
Puts them ahead with some count, puts them up by about 5 or 6 pins. So now Humphrey St. Francis needs to answer here with some sort of a mark, which will force Alma to mark again the 10th to win. It's a good release. Hand stays behind the ball. Chad Heyer comes from a bowling family. Mm-hmm. I do believe his grandparents owned the bowling center in Humphrey for quite some time.
And the messenger from across the lane. Head pin goes off the wall, comes across and trips the 10 out.
Larry, if you notice there on that approach, he was a lot slower with his feet. Didn't rush up to the line so fast. Good result.
Good count here will wrap it up for St. Francis in game number 1. Needs 7 or better, and that'll do it. So 149 in the 9th. Best that Humphrey St. Francis can.
Actually, you know what, Alma? Now, Bagger is going to shoot.
Flipped it around, you're right.
In the 170s, Alma will have match number 1.
It'll be Alma taking the first one. There you go. Scores flipped on you. So 180 possible for Alma. Humphrey St. Francis, he converts here with the 146.
Well, that 3 spare for, or 3 miss in frame number 4 for Humphrey cost him quite a bit of a pin count. And then in the 7th frame, that open frame there did 2. But Alma with quite a few strikes. Chance at 180 here with a strike. Gets it 180.
Out goes Brooklyn, and in to throw that last shot was the junior Nick Davis. Well, sports fans, NET is for you. We bring you more Nebraska high school sports than any other network. For more information on dates, times, DVD sales, and available webcasts, you can log on to netnebraska.org/sports. This is one of just many championships, of course, that we'll bring your way on NET Sports. High school swimming and diving, state bowling boys and girls championships, high school boys and girls basketball championships, wrestling, all coming your way in a very busy conclusion of the winter sports season on NET.
Very busy Larry Putney.
We try to stay that way. That's right. Keeps me out of trouble. Keeps me off the streets.
Luke Davis with the cover.
Watch Chad Heyer here on the right-hand lane. Big hands. Watch how he gets that thumb out of the ball early and rockets through that ball, flips that wrist. Just what he did there, Larry, was he pulled it a little bit, and there's so much condition here in the center of the lane. The ball has a tendency to slide through that oil, leaves the washout, the 1-2 and the 10.
And got the 10 pin out of the 7-10.
Good break there.
Yes.
You can see with Ryan Soderholm how, for Alma, how his hand is a little further behind the ball, where Chad's is a little more on the side. Gets a little more skid. Oh, just a
nice,
tough break.
Great run.
Yes.
So made a good run at it, but an open in the second frame for St. Francis.
Cross lane at the 7, got to pick those spares up. That's a good job. A lot of conditioner in the center part of that lane, Larry, sometimes going across the lane from right to left through that heavy oil conditioned area of the lane caused the ball not to hook enough. That's why we try to teach, especially young bowlers, to go straight at it. You don't have to hook the ball at all your spares. Go straight at it, improve your accuracy. Great shot there, solid 10.
So up on the right-hand lane, here's Brandon Vike. Vike with the high average on this squad and picks it up.
Now we'll see how he shoots the 10 pin, if he'll hook it the other way, and he does without the thumb. How about that? You know, that's like watching watching Major League Baseball pitchers to throw knuckleballs and how they have a million different release points and have, you know, a slider and a fastball, and then you got the knuckleball in there. That's has a large repertoire of releases, but that's okay. Versatility is great in bowling. You get on a pair of lanes, it's a little tougher. You need more accuracy. If you can do different things to the ball with your release, that's always good.
Well, it's an 11-pin Alma lead through the first three frames. One making nine. One spin pair spare conversion for Alma to extend that lead. And good conversion.
Try to talk too much about our left-hander there today for St. Francis. Robbie Rakas playing on out towards the edge of the lane on the left side. Right-handers play a little more towards the center of the lane. The lefties will have to play a little closer to the edge of the gutter.
Slama right up the board. Slama in the pocket and carries. Three strikes on the day for Slama.
I like Luke's release here for Alma. Luke Davis. Good compact game, solid at the line, right in that track area. Just pulled a little, looks like he might have hung in the thumb hole just a touch to pull that ball, but most of the right-handers are gonna be right in that second arrow area between about the 10th board, which is the second arrow, maybe just a touch inside. You'll see the ones that hook it a little more, like Ryan Soderholm, be a little deeper, setting the ball further out towards the gutter and then back.
And a good spare conversion. That was an important fourth frame for both squads, or make it fifth frame, as it's all even now at 66 as they flip. I want to remind you, you can preserve the 2012 Nebraska High School Girls and Boys Bowling Championships with a DVD copy offered by the Nebraska High School Bowling Federation. For your copy, log on to nhsbf.com, follow the links, and you can preserve your state championships for a lifetime. Folks in Humphrey will be grabbing a DVD copy of this, especially from St. Francis. Must have been an interesting little conversation in the town of Humphrey, because yesterday in the first round of the Bakers, it was Humphrey versus Humphrey St. Francis. And it went down to a fifth game, Steve, and Humphrey St. Francis obviously won because they're here, but they won in that last game, shooting a 192 in Baker to 146. So Humphrey St. Francis makes it here, and Humphrey, the other half of the town, goes home.
Yeah. I didn't hear of any car burnings or anything last night in Humphrey, so I think most of the kids all know each other in town. And we've had Humphrey High here before in the past. They are a state champion back in 2007, I do believe. And, you know, just a great community, small little bowling center, the hub of activity in the area there. You know, it's just such a great deal for the high school and the kids that have bowling as a sport. And, you know, this has been a really, really well-executed spare match so far. Just two open frames now between the two teams so far through the seventh. And there's been some tough spares converted like that one.
Yep. So a 9-pin advantage for St. Francis as we head to the eighth, 115-106, both with a spare working. Here's the lefty, Robbie Brockhaus. Brockhaus crossover and gets a carry. So Brockhaus with the strike. And that will extend the lead for the Flyers. Important shot. He just crosses over. Good. He gets the 10 out and avoids that 3-10 split. You're wondering how St. Francis did in the semifinals. They also went five games in the semis against Lee. So nothing new to go five for this St. Francis Flyer squad. And a big double by Evan Eicher to extend that lead.
Well, Allen needs to convert the spare right now. Strike up in the ninth to get back in the match. That's not going to help. 134 in the eighth. So best that Alma can shoot, Larry, would be 194 if they went off the sheet in the ninth and the tenth, where Humphrey right now is going at about a 215 pace.
So up is Luke Davis. Needs to get something going here. Can he get the carry? He can't. Kicks that two out of the 2-8, though, so that will certainly help from the conversion standpoint. But
so, yeah, you saw Luke when he let go of the shot. When it came off his hand, the ball just hung a touch on his thumb, just popped up in the air just a few inches. That was just enough to get that ball to skid a little further down the lane and not come up into the pocket area. The pocket on the right-hand side is the one and the three. First two pins on the right side. It's going to hit right at the ninth pin.
Saw a good conversion there, and their best possible score now, 184. Humphrey St. Francis, with good count here, can wrap it up.
I think you'll see Chad here right down the second arrow, right in between the second and third arrow.
Lane. Ooh, well, that makes it interesting, but I think still enough. 61, not quite over yet. An opportunity for Soderholm here. He'll wind it up and bury them all. So now let's do a little math here, Steve. 80.
Math.
87. Best they could use 84.
That's it. I was going to say all Humphrey needed there was some count.
No, he has to have one here, Steve. He has to have one of these remaining pins to shut him out. And he doesn't. So the 9-pin count will lead to a total score of 189, 184, the best Alma can do. So Humphrey St. Francis comes back in game number two and wins it 189 as the second one is buried too, and he may have needed every one of those pins that he ended up getting. Hey, let's take a look at the singles scores from the qualifying in Class D boys. These are the top 10 finishers. Justin Reiniger from Lee finished with a 537. He took state medalist honors. Jacob Peters from McCool Junction finishing second. Ryan Soderholm, who's finishing up right here on lane 28 in game number two. He finished third, and it went Alma, 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 Luke Davis, and Levi Kindler. And then a couple of Dodge bowlers in Chris Pieper and Nathan Cathell. Brandon Fike from St. Francis, the only Flyer to make the top 10. He finished with a 476. So top five there, first team All-State, second five, second team All-Tournament. All-State tournament team. So congratulations. So game number two is won by St. Francis, 189-182. All even now at one game apiece in this best of five Baker final. A nice way to start by Chad Heyer.
Little lineup change there. Chad leading off instead of bowling second, so Chad will be bowling the first, the fifth, and the ninth frames. We'll see who Coach Hostreiter puts in for his anchor bowler, and it is going to be Lynn Slama. Quickly up. Don't forget Baker Bowling. The whole team fills the entire game sheet. Classes C and D, it's four players. As you'll see later on when we get to classes B and A, it'll be five players. Everybody bowls two frames. 139, got to go right at it, just like you would with your strike shot. Ball hooked just a little bit, chopping the three off the nine.
So that opens the door a bit for Soderholm here.
Watch this release. Larry Hand comes around the ball, just fires through it with a rapid arm motion. And what you'll see with the big hook like that is you'll see some splits, especially if they come up light, leaving the double wood. That's the 2-8-10. That's a really difficult spare. Split on the opposite lane now for Humphrey St. Francis.
Evan Eicher goes a little high. Now a tough conversion. Really tough conversion here for Soderholm.
See him go just after the two pins.
Run at it. All you can hope there is you hit that first pin just light enough that you still take out the eight and send the two across the lane. That's a tough, tough conversion. So both sides, three straight opens here now in frames two and three. And another split, leaving the 5-10.
Ball just not finishing when Brent's shot there hit the pocket. The ball was not really going through the pins very well. It was kind of fading to the right and leaving that 5-10.
To Robbie Brockhaus.
Makeable split though here, the 5-10. You'll want to get the ball to the left of the 5. Slide it into the 10. It's got a chance, Larry.
Yeah, it does. Nice conversion.
Gives a little fire in the belly of the Alma boys. We've seen this before where you get into your third game and everybody might be trying to make a few adjustments and some odds and ends, trying to get lined up. And sometimes that leads to a few errant shots.
So back up on the left-hand lane, Chad Heyer. Heyer averaging 165 on the year. Can't quite slap that 10 out.
It's a good shot though, right in the pocket. Leaves the weak 10, but it was a good shot. In state tournament bowling, you want to be in the pocket area.
And another open by Alma, their third in four frames. In fact, the only conversion Alma has had in the first four is that tough 5-10 conversion by Brent Jansen.
St. Francis now with three opens in the row. This is a simple 10-pin conversion. Cross lane, a lot of speed, straight at it, just like that.
A nice conversion there. And they hold on to that slim 3-pin lead. For the crossover, a little heavy. Leaves a 6-7-10. Does Luke Davis.
Well, with a match this close, you go cross lane and try to just get two pins. If you get lucky and bounce it out of the pit area of the pin spotter, you get a little bonus. You'll go cross lane. Might have
got
a chance.
A run. So it takes that 10 off of the 6 as he made a run for it. 48 in the 5th. Humphrey St. Francis 43 in the 4th with a spare working. Hey, log on to Facebook.com/NET Sports and become a fan. You can leave questions, comments, and see what happens behind the scenes. Plus, follow what's coming up next on NET Sports. It's fast, fun, and easier than ever. Become a part of Nebraska's only statewide sports network. Facebook.com/NET Sports. You're going to like us, right? From your Facebook page?
I've got
probably three or four Facebook accounts.
Yeah, you know, I'm a social media butterfly.
Oh, you're demographic.
I'm on Twitter, buddy.
Are you?
I'm hashtagging like crazy.
Your demographic has become the largest growing demographic in Facebook. It's the grandfathers and grandmothers that are really becoming big Facebook users now, I hear.
Almost there, pal. Almost. Not quite an official senior yet.
Oh, okay.
A few years away.
I apologize.
Wait for the senior tour opportunities for me. You'll see our thumbless bowler here, who has been around the pocket and has had a had good success with keeping the ball in play, but just hasn't had a lot of breaks. And that is there's another split, 4-5.
We talked about the thumbless bowling. The other thing that's become somewhat of a rage is the two-handed bowlers.
Yes.
We're starting to see more two-handed bowlers as well, just because of their ability to create more room, throw it a little harder.
Maximum revolutions. We have several kids in Nebraska high school bowling that do use that method.
You may see one here later today. Class B, I believe, got a two-handed bowler.
They might. I heard his coach didn't coach that style, though.
Oh, he did.
Mike. Oh, he did?
Mike covers it up.
Well, it's all about power and gaining an advantage. You know, in golf, you know, we use a lot of golf comparisons to bowling, how there's always equipment improvements in golf. You know, the grooves on the golf club, face of a golf club change, swing changes, all sorts of things. In bowling, you have your share of it, too. And two-hand craze is beginning to take hold. Well, that was a very
great
nice shot.
Roll, absolutely. Terrific roll by Robbie Brockhouse, and you could see it get into a roll early and really get up into the pocket.
Made a nice adjustment there, move a little further out towards the gutter, get a little more hook into the lane. Right now, St. Francis with about a 25-pin lead right now with that strike working in the eighth. A strike here by Chad Heyer will really put it to Alma.
Boy, big shot by Heyer. St. Francis with the double in the eighth and the ninth, extending that lead.
I like
30-pin plus lead now, Steve.
Sorry about that, Larry. I like Luke Davis's game. Oh, and he gets the strike right in that track area. So not shut out yet. It all depends upon what happens here in the 10th frame.
156 possible for Alma. Humphrey St. Francis in the position again where just keep it on the lane, get some pins, and they're likely going to wrap this up. And leaves the 2-5. So right now, 47-53. He needs to pick this up, and in order to stay in it, Soderholm must have this, and he doesn't. So game number two will go to the Flyers. So back-to-back games in which the Flyers kind of opened it up in the second half with a double, and Alma with a bit of a stumble and a not converting on a spare, and St. Francis went into the 10th frame with the game pretty much at hand.
Five out of six frames there in the middle of the game were open frames or splits. That was the tail of the tape there. But this is match play bowling, head to head. So no matter how many pins you lose by, it's wins and losses.
Lynn Slama comes in and slams the door for Humphrey St. Francis. 169 is their total.
Substitution there for Alma.
35.
Nick Davis, freshman.
So 169, 135, the final in game three. And after dropping the first game 181-146, St. Francis has come back to take the next two. That one, 69-35. So St. Francis a game away. The Flyers need this one to wrap up a state championship in Class D. And Humphrey St. Francis, of course, your defending state champion. They won it last year, knocking off Clarkson in the finals, trying to make it 2 years in a row. So Luke Davis will start it off in the left-hand lane for the Cardinals. 2-4-5 with some work to do.
Well, we're seeing a little bit of transition in the bowling lane now. The conditioner we spoke of on the lanes that the bowling center puts on the lanes to protect the surface and to help with scoring does migrate a little bit. It moves, especially with these highly reactive, highly hooking bowling balls, has a tendency to carry that conditioner down the lane with it. So you'll begin to see some subtleties now as the lane changes, as that conditioner pattern gets a little beat up or tore up, as we call it in bowling. But it's all about spares, Larry, and it starts right here. St. Francis can keep clean with as few, if not zero, opens, you're going to see a team that's going to be tough to beat. Cross lane at the 7-pin.
He's to hook.
Oh. And that's exactly what happened. That lane conditioner carrying down the lane, ball could not hook through that heavy conditioner. And we've seen it now twice with Mr. Soderholm here. Ryan, who had a very sharply breaking ball back in the second game. Ball is not finishing quite enough yet. He'll need to be able to move a little bit to the right to get it to hook a little bit sooner.
Nice, smooth shot by Lynn Slama, who continues to rack up the strikes. It's a nice move to that anchor position by Coach Hostreiter. He saw that Slama pulling well, moved him down to that anchor spot, and he's delivered. Brandon Veit, a little high, leaves the 6-10. Veit, as we said, averaged 174 in district play this year. He now has that 6-10 conversion. Try to keep it close.
Spare here will get him back in the game. Does. Puts them within a couple of pins now based on what Alma does here on the spare. One of the issues with bowling with no thumb is your accuracy on spares. It's easier to hang on to the ball and direct it if you got all three of your fingers in there, three of your five, and sometimes spares do suffer a little bit when you're going thumbless or with two hands.
Crossover strike. So St. Francis back into the lead by 9. They had trailed after that open in the first frame, but the 3-5 in the third hurt Alma in count and also did not get the mark. And here, a tough 5-10 lead. So a big opportunity here for Chad Heyer to double up and extend that lead to 20. Maybe 30, given that his opponent's on a split.
A little slower, less speed. Pulled it, though.
Yep.
A little quicker the first couple shots there.
You'd like to see him move his feet and his eye target to the right.
Yes.
And just find a little bit of those drier boards on the outside as we're playing in a house shot.
A lot of conditioner in the center of the lane, and not as much towards the edge. When we get a little bit later on in our Class B and our A matches, you'll see more and more of the contemporary style, which you'll see people really using the advantage of the reactive resin ball and a lot of hook to send pins a-flying. That was a big spare there, Larry, that keeps St. Francis well ahead in the lead. Alma's got to find a spark here.
It's a 21-pin advantage. Very direct approach by Luke Davis, and Luke crosses over, leaves the 6-pin. Luke on the year averaged 134. He's a senior. He had 158. Sorry about that, Luke. He's a junior averaging 158. Cross lane conversion, and he got it. So through five frames, it's a 21-pin lead. Both teams working on spares as they bowl the first five frames on one lane, switch sides for the second five in this best of five of Baker Games championship format. Class D state championship, our first of the day. C, B, and A coming up yet this morning here on NET. And again, Lynn Slama, the senior, has just been money. Slama averaged 158 during the year, but he...
Low maintenance game, Larry. Absolutely. Not a lot of mistakes. Right down the middle, not a lot of hook. Picks his spares up, doesn't get in a lot of trouble.
Veit crosses over. Does he get the carry? 5-10 and out for Veit. Big, big double up by 21, and they will extend that lead to 30 plus.
Well, now what you're going to see here is for Alma, you're going to see Brent Jansen here, who will be coming up next. Just about half to strike to have a chance to stay in it. Down by 30 right now. Yep. Cut that lead to 20 on the strike here. Ball's going to have to put
it up. Got him all but the two pin. So two still standing. An important conversion for Alma in that if they're going to get back in this, they are going to have to string some together or hope for a mistake from St. Francis. So they must spare as St. Francis. Robbie Brockhaus with the conversion. So as you said, a 30-pin advantage. And a must-spare situation.
That's got to hook a lot, Larry.
Just slid right by it, and that'll open that lead up now to 42 pins. Nope. Yep, 42.
Well, you've got two very, very good bowlers here to finish out what's going to be a state championship here for St. Humphrey St. Francis. Chad Heyer just pretty much rocketing it at the head pin, trying to not do anything ill-advised, leave the 10-pin.
Tried to slide that 10-pin off the deck, didn't he? It slowly worked its way, but didn't quite carry.
Nick Davis, the other freshman for Alma, is going to come in and finish up.
So now on the left-hand lane. Spare conversion for Heyer.
Cross lane, a lot of speed.
So not locked out of it yet. Still with a outside chance, but they would have to pick this spare up and go off the sheet or throw four consecutive strikes. So a must spare here, and he got it. Good job by Nick Davis.
Well, Luke Davis, big brother, is going to have to strike here. If it's not a strike, Humphrey St. Francis will win their second in a row, right, Larry?
That's right.
It's a good shot there by Luke, right in the pocket area. Just
doesn't quite get it, so that will do it. So congratulations to the guys from Humphrey St. Francis. The Flyers, back-to-back years, have won state championships. As is typical in high school bowling, the celebration waits until the other team is complete.
Showing good sportsmanship there.
That's right.
Well, and you know, Larry, up there in that little area of northeast Nebraska around Dodge, Humphrey, Lee, Clarkson, Plainview, Wayne, who we'll see a little bit later on here. A hotbed of high school bowling. That's probably our most, with the exception of probably the Lincoln metro area, probably our most concentrated area of high school teams, all bowling either Class C or Class D.
Yep.
And some of these bowling centers, like Corey Hostreiter's Humphrey Lanes there in Humphrey, some of them host three or four teams.
Look at Sama. He's just been money. Very unassuming young man.
It's still early. Corley, or he may be sleeping.
That's right. I think we just saw a ball change. I believe we just saw a ball change the last two shots from Soderholm, and you saw the difference in the reaction that he got once he made that ball change. So obviously he went to something with maybe a little different cover stock or maybe...
Moved a little bit to the right, too, trying to generate a little more hook.
And so now in to throw the shot is Robbie Mosbach, and Mosbach
Jacob Mosbach.
Yep, thank you, Jacob Mosbach.
Yep, a little more hook on that ball. And, you know, for a freshman, Ryan Soderholm has a great game.
Yep.
That's a great fundamental game. As he grows, gets a little more beef on that body, he'll gain more momentum. He'll gain more leverage on that ball, and we'll probably see him back here in years to come. That's going to do it. The Flyers are state champs in Class D boys.
And an outstanding 194 for their final Baker game. So Humphrey St. Francis, the Flyers, back-to-back state champs. They win it today 3-1 over Alma. When we come back, we'll have trophy presentations and hear from your state champs on NET Sports.
Time Warner Cable is dedicated to the future of our nation's children. That's why we've launched our Connect a Million Minds initiative. We're asking adults to help us inspire kids through science, technology, engineering, and math. And we're achieving this through local partnerships with FIRST. Across the country, Time Warner Cable employees are helping bring FIRST robotics competitions to the areas we serve. The future of our nation and our children depends on math, science, and technology. Visit connectamillionminds.com to find out what you can do.
I just wanna be okay, be okay, be okay. I just wanna be okay today. I just wanna be okay, be okay, be okay. I just wanna be okay today. I just wanna feel today, feel today, feel today. I just wanna feel something today. I just wanna be okay, be okay, be okay. I just wanna be okay today.
Did you know that Nebraska teachers use NET documentaries and online content in the classroom to enhance history and literature curriculum? NET provides services that educate, entertain, and enlighten.
Thanks. Boy, a wild crowd bright and early here at Sun Valley Lanes. Congratulations to you guys. Coach Hofstreiter, back-to-back championships now. And you got your ice water in your veins, anchor bowler here, Lynn Slama. You made a change in your lineup at the beginning of the fourth game. You want to just explain what your thoughts were?
He was throwing some strikes there, leading us off, and we knew we were going to need him against their anchor man because he was throwing strikes in the tenth. So I switched it up, and he got her done, my little freshman.
Who's taller than both of us. Yeah. So what do you think? So when Coach made that change, what was going through your head? Did you have any thoughts about like something like, oh, my gosh, what's he trying to do to me? Or what were you thinking when you got up there in the fourth game to make that change and to know you have to strike more?
Well, I kind of just thought, lucky me. didn't really think of much, just thought I was lucky.
Focused on your game. He was focused on his game. That's what I teach him. So,
well, that's great. Well, congratulations to Humphrey St. Francis, back-to-back state champions here in Class D boys. Larry, back to you, pal.
All right, thanks, Steve. Nice job, and congratulations once again to the back-to-back state champs. And now for the trophy and medal presentation, let's go to our public address announcer, Greg Porchy.
Ladies and gentlemen, how about a nice round of applause for our two finalists? And now for our awards presentation, your Class D boys runner-up, the Alma Cardinals. Coached by Chris Mahalik and Rich Soderholm. Brett Jansen. Levi Kindler. Luke Davis. Nick Davis. And Ryan Soderholm. And here's your runner-up trophy. Again, congratulations to the Alma Cardinals, your Class D boys runner-up. Now, here's your 2011-2012 Class D Boys Champions, the Humphrey St. Francis Flyers. Coached by Corey Hofstreiter. Brandon Vike. Chad Heyer. Evan Eicher. Lynn Slama. Robbie Brockhouse. Caden Wemhoff. And Jacob Masbach. And here's your championship trophy. Congratulations to the 2011-2012 Class D Boys Champions.
Smile, guys. Gee, Merry Christmas.
Well, congratulations to the Humphrey St. Francis Flyers, Class D State Champs. It's a less than excited bunch there. I think they were excited halfway through, right, Steve?
Ah, the joys of television. That's right. Hey, this gives the guys in the editing truck something to do.
So congratulations to the Class D State Champs. When we come back, Class C competition headed your way. Wayne takes on Cedar Catholic. That's coming up next. Whoops.
Brought to you in part by the Ellen and Marcia Bear Foundation and by the Nebraska High School Bowling Federation, encouraging high schools to sanction the sport of bowling across Nebraska.
Hey, college doesn't just happen. You have to push yourself as you go through high school. Don't be afraid to take classes like Algebra 2, Biology, or a foreign language. They can help raise your ACT score and prepare you for college. I wasn't the smartest kid in high school, but I took the top classes and I passed. So what are you waiting for? Push yourself over to your counselor's office and sign up for them. They won't be easy, but you'll be glad you did.
Hello, I'm Jeff Beckman. If you're like me, Nebraska high school and college sports have been a big part of your family's life for many years. And if you'd like to see sports action continue for future generations on NET, consider making a legacy gift. Feel free to call me directly to discuss how easy it is to support our endowment fund and to keep sports action alive for generations to come. Thank you for your support of sports action here on NET.
Welcome back to Sun Valley Lanes in Lincoln, Nebraska. Now time for the Boys Class C State Championship. But first, I want to remind you, if you'd like to get a DVD of this or any of our Nebraska High School Bowling State Championships, you can log on to www.nhsbf.com. That's for Nebraska High School Bowling Federation. Follow the links, click through, order a DVD of the state championships, and collect these memories and save these memories for a lifetime. Well, let's take a look at the starting lineups for this Class C State Championship showdown between the Wayne Blue Devils and the Hardington Trojans. We'll start with the Blue Devils from Wayne. Head coach Dusty Baker. He has two freshmen on his team, Brady Ping and Chris Bird. Three seniors in Corey Dorlog, Keith Hobza, and Sean Ganzaboom. And then two juniors, Dylan Whelan and Stephen Moore. That's a look at the Wayne Blue Devils. The Hardington Trojans. Head coach Jimmy Anderson, assistant coach Mike Emanuel, Andrew Walter, Connor Weisler, Derek Klug, Eric Cruzy, Ross Wentz, Seth Howell, and Steve Herbelsheimer is a junior. So that's a look at Cedar Catholic, the Hardington Trojans, and the Wayne Blue Jays. Guys are on the lanes warming up. When we come back, it'll be time for competition. The Class C State Championship on the line between Wayne and Hardington, right after this.
Brought to you in part by the Ellen and Marcia Bear Foundation and by the Nebraska High School Bowling Federation, encouraging high schools to sanction the sport of bowling across Nebraska.
A diesel-powered engine on a farm works hard and operates in a grueling environment. Soy biodiesel fuels stand up to the challenge of powering farm equipment, but are also renewable and environmentally responsible as well. The Nebraska Soybean Board is committed to encouraging the use of soy biodiesel to protect the environment and sustain Nebraska's agriculture. The Nebraska Soybean Checkoff, growing opportunity from the ground up.
Always there when the day begins. And we exist to generate your power. deliver it safely, and answer your call. We are always there through snow and storm. We reconnect lives and make things brighter for your family and ours. Nebraska Public Power District. Always there when you need us. Together with your local public power utility.
Welcome back to Sun Valley Lanes in Lincoln, Nebraska. I want to remind you sports fans that NET is for you. We bring you more Nebraska high school sports than any other network. For more information on dates, times, DVD sales, and available webcasts, you can log on to netnebraska.org/sports. These boys high school state championships, just one of two, we'll be bringing you next Sunday right here back on NET. We'll have the girls state high school bowling championships for you. Should be a good couple of weekends of high school bowling right here on NET. And don't forget swimming and diving coming your way, wrestling, both basketball championships.
Do you wear the uniform similar to what the athletes wear when you do the play-by-play for these other sports?
Only wrestling and swimming.
All right.
Right.
That's got to do a lot for viewership, you know?
Sends it through the floor, honestly. A good start by Wayne. Now up on the right-hand lane, here's Hardington. And Derek Klug. Klug crosses over and gets the strike. So not how he drew it up, but it all looks the same on the scoreboard. They don't ask how, they just ask how many, and in that case it was 10. On the left-hand lane, Dylan Whelan. Whelan with the conversion.
Very good effort there. He changed his form completely for that cross lane spare, threw it hard and straight. Took a little something off the ball.
So now up on the right lane for Hardington, the Trojans, Seth Howell. Howell working on a strike, climbs the hill, leaves the bucket on the left side, 2-4-5-8.
These teams competed in the qualifying here at Sun Valley Lanes, although the lane conditioning pattern was a little bit different. This will give them a little bit of an assistance in kind of judging where to stand, where to play the lanes.
There's the best average bowler on the team for the Blue Devils, Corey Dorlog, the senior, averaging 182 on the year. So obviously bowling in that second position, which means he will bowl three times in one game. He'll bowl in the second frame, in the seventh frame, and again in the 10th. Sixth frame, sorry. Second, sixth, tenth.
Cross lane 2-4-5-8. A lot of different ways to miss that.
Yep.
Need to just almost virtually hit it straight on.
So a door log now. With a good cover. So right out of the buck. Wayne back-to-back marks in the first two frames and takes a lead. Wayne has certainly been here before. Wayne has won two of the last three state championships. They won it in 09, in 10. Didn't make it to the finals last year, but they're back here in 2012. And a good shot and a strike by Hardington there. Crossover. Jan Zabam, a senior, averages 145, now up on the left lane. Number 26, Andrew Walter. Walter is a junior.
We may have most of the Hardington Cedar Catholic basketball team here, too, as there's at least three guys in this team that are about 6'4", 6'5".
All right, so good finish there by Walter. He gets 9.
Keep the ball in play. Not a lot of hook, just right down that track area of the lane.
Gansbaum now to convert his spare. Gansbaum with a good cover. So Wayne off to a solid start here. Three single pin counts, three straight spares. That is so key in these state championship matches. If you can pick up your spares, you'll be successful.
Well, we've already seen it today in the earlier matches. The earlier match, I should say. Ooh.
That slides just by that.
Most everybody, bowling on fresh lane conditions here at Sun Valley Lanes in Lincoln are a little worried about the ball not hooking enough, where you'll see some people pull the shot a little bit.
Right. Crossover there by Keith Hubza leaves the five pins, and now up on the right-hand lane for the second time this game is Derek Klug. Klug struck his last time. Straight up the boards, crosses over, as he did the first time. This time, though, leaves the 3-10, so a spare upcoming for Klug.
Just a little bit of a pull shot there, tugged it a little bit at the five pin. Another no thumb bowler. We had one in our Class D match earlier today. Another one of the contemporary ways to bowl, as people are using either no thumb or two hands now. I've done that back in my days at Sky Lanes in Omaha growing up. The coaches would hit me over the head with something. Yeah, you know, you just,
that's true.
How much things change in the game. As if it isn't the equipment, it's the way to release the ball, any way to gain an advantage.
Sky Lanes, that was 42nd.
Right, center mall, fifth level. Ball,
that's right. Yep. Hold there a few times myself in junior
bowl. Just to walk there with PBA great Rich Abood, and grew up there, and probably one of the top junior programs in all the state. As a matter of fact, we used to bring our juniors down to go head-to-head against the juniors at Hollywood Bowl in Lincoln.
Is that right?
Yep, all those years ago, back when they still had octopuses and monkeys setting pins, you know, even before, men or boys. So not
Dylan,
that far ago.
Dylan Whelan opens for the first open of the game for Wayne. So they have 84 through 5, still a 10-pin advantage. Hey, I want to remind you, you can download our new NET Radio Nebraska mobile app and listen to NET's radio. Just look for the free NET Radio Nebraska app in the iTunes or Android app markets. Brand new NET exclusive app. Good shot by Hardington on the left lane.
So let me get this straight. We'll be on iTunes, you and I?
No, it's an app for radio.
Oh, I got it.
Yeah.
that would have meant we made the big time.
Corey Dorlog on the right hand lane. With a 9-pin count. Back on the left lane. Here's Eric Cruzy.
Slower release there, trying to get the ball to hook a little more.
And it did. Came a little high for Cruzy.
Hung in the ball just a little bit on the release, Larry. Just hung in there just enough to pull that shot just a little bit left.
Cruzy had struck last time up. And another good spare conversion for Corey Dorlog. Dorlog back-to-back 9 spares. And a nice job by Wayne here. Just being solid, picking up the spares they leave as they continue to try to get lined up. He might be playing right up second arrow, it looks like, and maybe a move slightly right would be beneficial.
I think that's very, very true, Larry. Need to move that ball just a little bit right to get a little more hook. That was just a little pull shot there. It's like you turn your hands over in golf and get the ball to hook. You do the same thing in bowling. You turn your hand over the top of that ball, and it'll usually go left immediately.
On the right lane, here's Andrew Walter. Walter crosses over, got it. That's what the Hardington Trojans needed to get back into this. You know, Hardington is a co-op program between Hardington Public and Hardington Cedar Catholic, and so they go by the Hardington Trojans, even though this year may be a bit unique in that all 7 bowlers are from Cedar Catholic.
It's still a co-op in the eyes of the Nebraska High School Bowling Federation. We follow NSAA rules, meaning that if the two schools co-op, for instance, we've had co-ops already from Louisville Board and some other schools in the past. We follow those rules. So even though all the players were from one particular school, when tryouts occurred and in the past, those two teams have co-opted.
Klug doubles up. And that has given them the lead here after Wayne came out with those 4 consecutive spares. They have faltered opening 2 of the last 3 frames.
See a lot of co-ops in the smaller sports. A lot of co-ops in swimming and diving, which you'll be doing here soon on NET. And other smaller sports, softball, baseball. Quite a few co-ops, especially in the smaller schools.
So Hubza with a 7-1, and now the wheels beginning to fall off a bit for the Blue Devils of Wayne.
A couple of frames in a row, both of them not the easiest spares, but makeable spares nonetheless.
And three of the last four as well, so an important ninth frame here as they find themselves down by 15.
That's a good shot, Larry.
Straight up the boards and solid, nice, solid shot by Dylan Whelan, his first strike of the match.
Well, a Hardington strike here in the first ball of the 10th frame is going to lock up this match number one virtually, unless there would be a big-time disaster to follow. So a strike here gives them a potential 190. 192 at the off sheet. That's a good ball.
Right at the boards again. Does he trip it? No. Four pin.
Possible 171 for Hardington with a spare and a strike here. Wayne, in order to have a chance to win this first game, needs a double right here in the 10th.
Just a little quick.
Yeah, you heard the boom, boom when you let go of the ball. It's a double dribble, basically. Ball comes off your hand a little fast, and that ball hits the foul line area of the lane. There's usually in most bowling centers, there's a very beefy piece of wood right at the foul line area because it takes a lot of impact, and that'll make that bounce, bounce noise. So
yep.
Hardington in the books for game number one.
Doggett cover by Seth Howell. Potential 171 for Hardington. A tough 210 spare conversion here for Dorlog. And gives it a run. Can't quite get it. And they'll be in the books now for 142. So there you see 142 for Wayne. Hardington 151 in the ninth. A strike here gives them a 171. They already have the game number one wrapped up. So 169. Let's take a look at the singles competition from yesterday. We'll take a look at the top 10 individuals in Class C. Anthony Dodge from North Bend East Butler won the medalist honors. Corey Dorlog, who we're seeing here today, finished second with a 596 in his three games. Derek Klug of Cedar Catholic finished with a 582. And you see the top five there, our first team All-State tournament. Next five are the second team All-State.
Have to watch that program in North Bend. Randy Dodge, one of the coaches in North Bend and the proprietor at North Bend, at Dodger Lanes in North Bend, is growing himself a very good program. They are going to be a force to be reckoned with. They've got several middle schoolers in our middle school program that are already averaging 180 to more. So we'll be seeing them in years to come, I'm sure.
Well, North Bend had the high individual with Anthony Dodge from North Bend East Butler, shooting 601. And North Bend made it all the way to the semifinals yesterday, but were knocked out by Cedar Catholic. And Hardington right now leading one game to none over Wayne, but a good start for the Blue Devils here in game number two.
I remember in years past, Larry, when Wayne made the TV show State Finals, the last time they won, which was 2010, that match went to all five games. It's the nice thing about Baker style bowling. If you lose by 100 pins that first game, it does not matter. Come back and win the next game just like in match play.
Little quick there.
See
1-2-7-9.
Sorry about that.
That's
Larry,
right.
You could see how fast his feet got, and by the time he got to the foul line, it took his arm a long time to catch up with his approach, causing that ball to miss target.
And a good ball, great shot, and a strike in the second by Hardington.
Hardington up in that little area in northeast Nebraska where all athletics are very good.
Yep.
You've got Hardington, Cedar Catholic up there. You've got West Point up there and Central Catholic. You've got West Point High, Pender. A lot of new schools that are going to be bringing on high school bowling here in years to come.
Ooh, Cruzy gets it to wobble but can't get it to go.
very, very competitive nature up there. Gotta pick the spares up now is what needs to happen.
Best football player to come out of Hardington Cedar Catholic. Or maybe Hardington the town.
Wow. Okay.
Russ, NFL lineman.
Yes.
Stein.
That's right. That's correct.
I think he won a couple of Super Bowls with the Patriots.
I do believe so. Cross lane at the four pin. A lot of conditioner in the center of the lane. Need to go straight at it. He's choosing to hook the ball at it. But with his slow speed, that yep. can be an optimum way to shoot at it.
Really a couple of different ways to go at spares now. I mean, most of your coaches these days are teaching straight at it. Really takes the lane and the ball surface out of play. Others still using it, 3-6-9, 4-8-12. Some are still using it.
and you know, with the advent of the reactive resin and urethane bowling balls, which really changed the game of bowling. Mm-hmm. Probably the biggest change in 30 years of the sport of bowling came with the invention of urethane bowling balls, and now reactive resin, which is a form of urethane. It's just caused the ball to become explosive and to hook. So those conventional spare shooting formulas of moving 3-6-9 based on where the spare was on the lane hit. I don't know, if some of that can be used more accurately. What you see and what you'll see like at the University of Nebraska with Coach Straub, and you'll see on tour, is they just teach people to either switch balls to a ball that goes straighter, or just take your hand completely out of the ball, throw it as hard and as straight as you can to eliminate error.
Had a good spare conversion by Andrew Walter. Yeah, the issue with the 3-6-9, and it's a nice mathematical formula that made it very easy for people to move three right based on what pin they left and throw their strike ball. The issue with it is now that lanes are getting chewed up so much earlier with the new equipment, they react so much more early on the heads. You get different reaction down the lane.
Right.
So it's just become much easier too.
When everybody was pretty much bowling on wood lanes on either lacquer or urethane finishes, and people were still using polyester bowling balls, that thing applied more accurately back in those days. Right now, you just want to, the name of the game is to saw the rack in half.
Right.
with the first ball, and that's why you're seeing more players use either no thumb or two hands.
At the head pin.
Will we see the two-handed bowler here in our next match, Larry?
I think we will see. He's a junior. Just picked it up last summer, but already averaging above 180. And the thing you like about him is, as you said, he opens up the lane. He has so much more room and ability to strike based on the speed and the amount of revs that he's able to get, and then his carry. He doesn't have to be as accurate because the carry is so much better. So typically, if it becomes a tough shot in a spare shooting match, he wouldn't bowl, but I think you might see him in the next match.
Well, Jason Belmonte, the pro bowler from Australia that's been on the PBA Tour for a long time, was really the first person to develop that. It's catching on. 10-pin lead right now for Hardington in game number two.
So the two sides will switch as they do. We'll take a look at the score, and it's Hardington, as you said, up by 10. Only one open for Wayne.
I like Seth Howell's game. Long arm swing, hooks the ball, not a lot, right in that track area, pulled it there. You saw his hand go to the top of the ball.
Saw the strike there by Seth Howell.
Just flipped it over a little early. Ball came off his hand, left the target, but he got it over far enough to make the strike. Similar game there. Corey Dorlog.
Yep. So Dorlog with an 8.
And as you can see, talking about two-handed bowlers versus thumbless bowlers, you can see that there's feast and famine. Obviously, we're talking about the next match coming up in Class B with our lovely Larry Putney here. We'll be moving to the coaching circle and one of his bowlers. And, there's feast and famine to that game where you can use that to be such an advantage. But just like you said, Larry, if the lanes become tougher and if there's a lot of spare shooting, nothing beats accuracy. I'm not saying the two-handed or the thumbless bowlers can't be accurate. But,
Well, Cassidy Shaw, as you mentioned, Jason Belmonte, they've proved you can be accurate. I mean, they've proven that with enough practice, like anything, you can become accurate. The advantage, at least in my mind, from a two-handed perspective at this age, is you're able to become better so much more quickly.
And I think it is a distinct advantage to bowl on as many different lane conditions as you can. Now, at our bowling center in Omaha, we're the host of five high school teams. And we regularly, during their practice regimen, put out different lane condition patterns, not just the normal house condition is what you see most places you go. But, you know, depending upon whether you bowl at Sun Valley Lanes or whether you go to the bowling center in Hardington or the bowling center in Wayne, the conditions are going to be different. It's just like golf. You need to be able to hit every club in your bag, Larry, not just the driver and the putter.
So a nice strike and a good shot there by Andrew Walter. So Walter with his second strike of the match. Now back up on lane four is Sean Ganzenbaum. And Ganzenbaum cross lane converts. So a big spare conversion for Ganzenbaum.
Both teams being very efficient right now. Just one open frame on that split for Wayne in the fourth. As you can see, Hardington clean through eight. They can shoot over 200. Right now they're on a 196 pace.
Here's Derek Klug.
Right up the track area, right around the second arrow. He just tugged it a little bit left. He saw it go across the arrows at about the 12th board. The second arrow is the 10th board. You count from the right across the lane, so each arrow is five boards. That was about two boards left to target. Just couldn't hold the pocket. That's not a cakewalk either to pick that split up. That is the 278.
Back-to-back splits for Hubza.
What you want to do here is you want to get the one pin. You're in a close match. You want to, because if you do not get the one pin here, you will lose two pins of count because you're on a strike.
So on the one for Klug and 164 now through nine. So it might have been, it is a big opportunity here. You see him without the thumb in the ball, turning it over. And that rotation really helps in converting a spare like that.
Caused that ball to hook hard at the back end. The last 15 to 20 feet of the bowling lane from foul line to the head pin is 60 feet. The last 10 to 15 feet is clean and dry. Now, some oil conditioner, whatever you want to call it, is carried down the lane. But when you can take your thumb out of the ball and put so much more revolutions on it, you can create a lot of hook in that back end.
Big shot here, crosses over, and leaves the five pin. So Wieland.
Well, Larry, a spare here by Wayne will bring them back within seven pins.
Yep.
And if they can also strike in the 10th, based on what Hardington will do, could put Wayne in the lead.
So tight game here in game number two. Hang on, got it. So a good conversion by Whelan. Tightens it back up for the Blue Devils. So an important 10th frame coming up here for Seth Howell. Now Seth, who's up on the right-hand lane, has struck both times this game. Great pocket shot back in the second frame. And then the sixth frame crossed over and carried.
Watch, he'll want to hit somewhere around the sixth or seventh board. Right up
right
to six board.
Five needs to hook.
Yep. He did not have the revolutions on that ball. It looks like he lost it a little bit. By losing it, we mean that the ball comes off your hand early and you do not get a chance for your fingers to rotate enough to get the ball to hook. So he leaves a tough spare, the two and the eight. He's going to come in from the right, make sure the ball carries out the two or carries the two into the eight.
And a great shot by Dorlov. His first strike of the match for the anchor bowler from Wayne. Boy, that was a pivotal shot because now a strike by Wayne and they can win this. This is a must spare for the Trojans.
From right to left, he's gonna hook the ball into the spare.
Needs to skid. So 67, that should do it. I'll just pin count and Wayne is gonna win this game number two. If he gets good pin counts.
Needs seven pins to win, Larry.
Right off the corner, that'll be enough. Great shot. See, he's made the appropriate move. Earlier he was playing at around seven or eight. He stepped outside, he's playing right off the gutter up five.
Well, if you look at the bowling lane from side to side, closer to the gutters, the closer you get to the outside of the lane, the drier it is. You'll get more hook. As you get into the center of the lane, more conditioner causes more skid. So the old adage, if you miss the pocket to the right, you move to the right. If you're a right-hander, you see he's out around the first arrow there. And threw that one quite a bit harder, but that was good enough.
So the final here, 185 to 173. Wayne comes back and takes game number two. It's all even now at one apiece. Hey, reminder, discover award-winning national programming and locally produced shows right at your fingertips on NET's video player. You can catch the episodes you might have missed, watch your favorite NET programs. You can do it whenever you want, all on your schedule. And best of all, it's free. Search, select, and share anytime online at video.netnebraska.org. So here we go, game number three, all even at a game apiece. Cedar Catholic wins the first. Wayne, thanks to a terrific 10th frame performance by Corey Dorlock, throwing three in a row, comes back and wins game number two, 185-173. And maybe expand a little bit, Steve, on a lot of people who may be the casual bowler, and we'll certainly have those tuning in on NET throughout these high school championships this week and the girls next week. And explain the process. This isn't, you know, a lot of people might go out and look at the pins and fire at the pins. There's a physics process involved here in knowing where to play the lane, where to get the best reaction, where to stand, and also where to look. And those arrows, those dots, they're out there for a reason.
Right, and even some of the newer bowling facilities you'll see have dark, on purpose, colored boards further down the lane. And basically, it's like throwing a baseball, Larry, at a target that's 10 feet away versus throwing it at a target that's 60 feet away. You're going to hit that target 10 feet away easier because it's closer. If you try to aim at the target 60 feet away, you know, you're going to hit it, but you're not going to hit it with as much accuracy. That's why the bowling lane has those rangefinders on them. And the object is to, you know, to use that as your targeting to play in the portion of the lane that you want. But a lot of things come into it too, Larry. You know, as you get to this age, and these young men are all you know, experienced bowlers, we'll say, they learn their game. They know how much the ball hooks. They know about what to expect when it comes to bowling ball reaction. So we saw it earlier in Class D with Alma, with Ryan Soderholm, who really hooked the ball a lot, who's playing deeper inside and having more hook. And then now we're seeing it with some of these boys here that still hook the ball, but they're a little more straight and direct.
A good 9-pin count there, left the 5-pin on the double. Seth Howell, who threw that last shot for Hartford and Cedar Catholic and struck in the second frame to give them a double, would love to have that in the previous game in the 10th frame. He's bowling well. He's got three strikes in his last four shots. It's just that one tough spare that he left in the 10th frame and missed it opened the door for the blue doubles.
Well, Larry, I'll tell you this. The bowling world lost the great Don Carter. Really old. You know, our parents knew who Don Carter was. I remember Don just because I was a big fan of him and Dick Weber as a kid. Yep. But probably your four or five greatest bowlers of all time would obviously be Dick Weber, Don Carter. Put Earl Anthony in there. Walter Ray Williams, obviously, in there. And then after you get that far, there's some argument as to who would be up in that echelon. The one characteristic with all four of those gentlemen was that they threw the ball pretty straight. They threw it very, very straight. Walter Ray has the ability to hook it, but Walter Ray also won a lot of tournaments throwing the ball very straight. Dick Weber, Don Carter, the same thing, even though they came from an era of the 50s and 60s where they're still bowling on shellac in some cases. I'm an advocate of teaching accuracy to bowlers. And when you can be very, very accurate, then you can start to develop the big hook and the power game because you're going to hit your mark more often.
Ganzebaum with a good conversion there on the 9 spare, now up in the right lane. Just chops it, does Andrew Walter. So after the double and the spare, the open might open the door a bit here for Wayne, who has been clean. Needs to climb, and tough washout. 1-2-4-10. Have to cross over and send that one into the 10 pin. Up on the right hand lane, here's Derek Klug.
Good straight arm swing by Derek.
Great ball by Klug. Back to back strikes for him.
And see, that bowling ball, Larry, probably did not hook more than three or four boards. He threw it pretty straight and direct with a good amount of speed. The ball finished just enough at the back end to carry everything out.
Goes up a bit light. Hubza goes six and out. Opens the door back up for Hardington. That was a big shot in the fifth for the Trojans.
Wayne needs to get back on it right here and come up with at least a mark to keep the game fairly close. Better shot.
Wheeling right off the corner, wheels it up. 6-10.
Spare here will keep them about 15 pins down. We've already seen some comebacks from a lot further than that.
Cross alley. Just chops that 10 off of the 6. So back-to-back opens for the Blue Devils, and the two teams will switch sides, which gives us an opportunity to remind you that Facebook.com/NET Sports is a place that you want to be and you want to become a fan of. That's where you can follow NET Sports, see what's happening behind the scenes, and get the latest on what's going on NET. It's fast, fun, and easier than ever to be part of the only statewide sports network. Facebook.com/NET Sports.
Larry, did you check us in here when you got here at Sun Valley Lanes this morning?
I did not.
You did not? You didn't check us in? How are people going to know what we're doing today?
A little high there on the shot from Seth Howell, who had struck three of his last four shots. 9 count. So here's a look at the other anchor bowler, Corey Dorlog, who has also struck in three of his last four shots.
Corey's got great form.
Make it 4-5. Dorlog beginning to warm up.
And we also talk about how the ball hooks, and we talked a little bit about the physics of bowling and things like that. The majority of these kids here on both teams, their ball has more of an end-over-end roll or a rotation to it instead of the, like in the Class D match we saw earlier today where there was a couple of young men that were really hooking the ball a lot more and they had more of an around-the-side rotation on the ball. Again, it's just all about what your game is and you know your limits of your game, but that, I still believe, creates a little more accuracy when you're a little more end-over-end. By end-over-end, the ball will hook a little less, but will store energy until it gets to the pins. That's a little more around the side of the ball.
Cruising a little high, left the 6-pin.
Saw that come off his hand, Larry, and the ball, instead of going out into the lane, the ball went up and then down onto the lane. That caused that little delay, just causes enough of a hang to get that ball to hook a little bit too much at the back end.
Ganzabam with the conversion. And he's only had one error in 6 frames as Ganzabam's very solid for the Blue Devils. Had a nice spare conversion there.
Very impressed with the simplicity of all these young men's games. Pretty good spare shooters. And just had a couple of opens there in the middle. But overall, very good spare shooters. Our bowler here for Wayne, Keith Hubza, decided to try the thumb in the ball that time, which you see that also happen.
Climb a bit.
Trying to stay accurate.
Leaves the 2. Walter with a 9-pin count and a chance to open this lead up. An important spare here for Wayne to stay in it. Slides by. To the left, so 112 in the 8th for Wayne. And Hardington building toward a 40-pin advantage through 8 frames. So an opportunity here for the guys from Cedar Catholic as that slides by and keeps the door open for Wayne.
Strikes only time now for Wayne if they don't want to go down in this match. Down now by 28, going into the foundation 9th. Big strike will set you up for the 10th frame. Looks like his target on the lane, pulled that ball. Pulled it enough though, Larry.
Yeah, crossover and gets the strike. Needed that in the 9th frame.
Potential 172, Larry, for Wayne Hardington. Can still shoot 200. They're on a 180 clip. A couple of marks here in the ninth and the tenth, and Hardington should have this game sewn up. Great shot.
Ought to do it right there.
Saw a good shot and a strike by Derek Klug, who's now thrown three in a row. Last three times up, he's put strikes on the board. And now Corey Dorlach, who has struck in four of his last five shots, really needs a double here for Wayne.
It's a good shot.
Yeah, and he got it. So a big shot by Dorlach.
He's going to need a little help, though, here. He's going to have to help for a little disaster here on the Hardington side of things. Seth Howell marks here. That'll wrap it up.
Yep.
Another good shot.
And a great ball. That will do it. Big shot by the Hardington Trojans. Seth Howell. Seth says, needed it this time of the 10th, and I got it.
This is pretty good bowling, Larry. This is real good. All these players are pretty accurate. Watch here as Seth gets up there. Watch how he keeps his hand behind the ball. You can see how he's got his fingers at 12 o'clock. You can see his fingers pointing straight up. Watch how his hand stays behind the ball until right at the end. Rotates it off his hand. He's just keep it in the center part of the lane there to avoid any real disasters. They're going to end up with about potential 188. Spare here will give Wayne 160. A couple of good games.
Saw a good cover by Dorlach. Eight spare. 160 even is what Wayne puts in the books. And looking for falls off. That won't count. Came out of the channel, so 186 is the score for Cedar Catholic. 186 to 160. The Hardington Trojans and the guys from Cedar Catholic on top, 2-1. I like what Coach Dusty Baker's doing right now, up off his chair, telling his guys, hey, let's stay focused. We're not out of this. We're down 2-1. We've done it before. We've come back. We can do it again. Wayne knocked off Burwell Ord 3-1 in the semis and knocked off Norfolk Catholic 3-1. Norfolk Catholic, of course, was the defending state champion on the girls' side last year.
Oh, almost out of the pit. Going to stay with Dylan Weiland here to lead off. Dylan really brought that arm around the front of his body there. Caused it to go high.
Oh, Klug. Try to convert and slides it by. Things tightening up a bit. One win away for Cedar Catholic from a state championship. Blue Devils trying to stay in it with a win here. Blue Devils, Wayne's certainly been here before. Nice conversion by Dylan Whelan. Of course, Wayne has won the state title twice in the last 3 years. Did not win it last year in 2011. Ravenna knocked off Wisner-Pilger in that championship match, but 2009 and 2010, Wayne beat Wisner-Pilger both years to win state titles, trying to make it 3 of 4 today. Find themselves in a 2-1 hole to Hardington.
This young man's game, simple, off the corner. Great shot.
This ball by Dorlach.
He's going to get him fired up back there in the settee area, Larry.
Yeah,
he's off, ready to butt heads.
He's warming up. He's got 6 strikes in his last
8 frames. Good cover there. Nice solid cover by Seth Howell. So Wayne with the early lead here in game number 4.
He's going to have to hook a little.
Jan Zibon comes up a bit light. And here's Kruse. Kruse, a senior, averaged 169 during district play. This is a Hardington team that has warmed up a bit throughout the year. Hardington really struggled in district play. They went 1-6. But how you perform down the stretch can have such an enormous impact. And
I tell you, a lot of football teams, basketball teams, that would start off and not light the world on fire, but by the time tournament time came or the bowl season came, that they were the team to beat. And bowling is a game that really demands practice, just like golf and other sports. You've got to practice. And we're at the end of the season here. These young men have been practicing since November, some before. Bit of a different approach there for.
And he got the carry on the Brooklyn.
The Cubs are there, moved outside a little bit, caught the drier portion of the lane, caused the ball to hook up a little bit. He washed out time before.
It's going to need to hook and get up, and it does, but leaves a 10 pin. Our first look at Steve Herbolsheimer. Herbolsheimer, a junior, averaged 151 now into the game for Hardington. On the right-hand lane, Dylan Whelan. Whelan crosses over, got the carry.
Still bringing that arm across the front of his body, but we got the break.
Yep. Saw a double for Wayne, and they're looking to force a fifth.
The spare is important here. Good cover.
Saw a solid shot by Herbolsheimer. Now back up is Derek Klug. Klug with 5 strikes on the day. Had 3 in a row prior to getting a 9 count in his last frame.
That's a good shot, Larry. Just maybe a little fast. Yep. Boy, he was right in the right part of the lane. Ball came off his hand well. Rotation of the ball looked good. Might have been just a little fast. He's the 2-4-5. We've seen this missed a number of different ways. But he's pretty hard and straight, so he's going to probably move over to the center part of the lane, go direct at it. Cut down on the margin for error. He's going to hook it into it.
Other side, got it. So I got the break as the two teams switch sides. You don't want to forget to get a DVD of these state high school bowling championships, both the boys this week, the girls next week. You can pick them up online at nhsbf.com. Log on, follow the links, and you can preserve your state championship memories for a lifetime. Grab a DVD of the state championships on nhsbf.com.
Way off the corner there. That ball comes roaring back. You see how dry the outside of the lane is. That ball started off at about the 5th board around the first arrow, got out to about the 3rd board, and it comes flying back from the edge and snaps out that 10.
3 in a row for the Blue Devils.
Another good shot.
Good ball. Nice carry by Seth Howell.
Wayne with a 3-bagger now, Larry, there.
Yeah. Threatening to run away here, aren't they? Up by 40. And extend it to 50 with the strike here. Needs to climb.
Hardington would like to end this now, but they are down by about 50 pins right now. A strike here will cut it to 40.
Got Kruse and a weak 10. Just not quite enough finish at that back end.
Ball labored through the middle portion of the lane. By laboring, it just struggled to get into a roll in that heavy condition part of the lane. But it was a good shot. Easy spare. Oh, it was an opening.
Shot.
Down by about 45 right now. A spare here by Hardington's Eric Kruse. And maybe a strike in the 8th will cut that lead to 25. Crossley at the 10, needs to throw it hard and straight. Well done.
Nice cover by Cruzy. Important shot here. He struck last time, did Keith Hubza. Hubza crosses over. And welcome back to Sun Valley Lanes in Lincoln, Nebraska. Now time for the Boys Class C State Championship. But first, I want to remind you, if you'd like to get a DVD of this or any of our Nebraska High School Bowling State Championships, you can log on to www.nhsbf.com. That's for Nebraska High School Bowling Federation. Follow the links, click through, order a DVD of the state championships, and collect these memories and save these memories for a lifetime. Well, let's take a look at the starting lineups for this Class C State Championship showdown between the Wayne Blue Devils and the Hardington Trojans. We'll start with the Blue Devils from Wayne. Head coach Dusty Baker. He has two freshmen on his team, Brady Ping and Chris Bird. Three seniors in Corey Dorlog, Keith Hobza, and Sean Ganzaboom. And then two juniors, Dylan Whelan and Stephen Moore. That's a look at the Wayne Blue Devils. The Hardington Trojans, head coach Jimmy Anderson, assistant coach Mike Emanuel, Andrew Walter, Connor Weisler, Derek Klug, Eric Cruzy, Ross Wentz, Seth Howell, and Steve Herbelsheimer is a junior. So that's a look at Cedar Catholic, the Hardington Trojans, and the Wayne Blue Jays. Guys are on the lanes warming up. When we come back, it'll be time for competition. The Class C State Championship on the line between Wayne and Hardington right after this. Welcome back to Sun Valley Lanes in Lincoln, Nebraska. I want to remind you sports fans that NET is for you. We bring you more Nebraska high school sports than any other network. For more information on dates, times, DVD sales, and available webcasts, you can log on to netnebraska.org/sports. These boys high school state championships, just one of two we'll be bringing you next Sunday right here back on NET. We'll have the girls state high school bowling championships for you. Should be a good couple of weekends of high school bowling right here on NET. And don't forget swimming and diving coming your way, wrestling, both basketball championships.
Do you wear the uniform similar to what the athletes wear when you do the play-by-play for these other sports?
Only wrestling and swimming.
All right.
Right.
That's got to do a lot for viewership, you know?
Sends it through the floor, honestly. A good start by Wayne. Now up on the right-hand lane, here's Hardington and Derek Klug. This is a winner-take-all game five. Winner takes home the state championship in Class C. Started off for the Wayne Blue Devils. On the left-hand lane will be Dylan Wheeland. Wheeland, a high game of 252, high series of 689.
Good shot. Wow, just got a little nosy there at the end. Not quite as hard. Caused that ball to hook up just a little bit, but safe shot here. Now we'll see if we have any arm swings to get a little tight, Larry. We know that this is it for all the marbles and that big state championship trophy.
And trips the four pin forward. Big shot by Derek Klug. That's Klug's fourth strike in his last five shots. Good time to be getting high.
Oh, my.
Wayne
looked like
just
going right at it.
Looked like it. Slides it right by. Does Wheeland. It's an important shot here with the other team opening. You can really put some early pressure on. And Seth Howell certainly knows it. Tugged it a little bit. He's got the hold. It does, but leaves the three pin.
He Yeah, he kind of feathered that ball just a little bit.
So now up on the left-hand lane, Corey Dorlog.
Corey here will keep his hand behind the ball until right at the end, causing that ball to be hard at the back end. Almost gets the wall shot there. Spares are important now, Larry.
Yep.
No more room for errors. Hardington can keep an 11-pin lead with this spare here. No problem.
And a good cover by Seth Howell, who's a senior heading to Nebraska Lincoln next year to study economics.
Hold it.
Man, held up.
A lot of oil in the center of the lane there. Looked like it came off his hand quite a ways left of target.
Yep.
11-pin lead now.
So up on the right-hand lane is Eric Cruzy.
Hung in the ball there. Thumb popped. You can hear that popping noise right when it came out.
Sean Ganzebaum back on lane four. Ganzebaum, a senior. Wants to go into golf course management. He's a golfer as well as a bowler.
Spares are needed here. 5-pin should just be a normal shot right down the middle of the lane, just like throwing a strike, no problem.
And a good cover. Pressure back on the left-hand lane with Ganzebaum. Hang on.
Got it.
So Ganzebaum with the 9 spare. Through 2, an 11-pin lead by Hardington.
Back and forth, back and forth.
Crossover by Andrew Walter. And Walter with high fives.
Might come down to the first person to blink first.
Oh, what a shot. You can really see how Hubza moved outside on that shot, went straight up, looked like about board 5, and finally started getting some of that reaction he was looking for.
And he needed that. He's kind of struggled here the last couple of games. That was a great shot.
Yeah, he had split, 6-6, and now he's backed it up with back-to-back strikes.
Let's see what happened there on that particular shot for Derek Klug. He kind of got to the line a little quick. You can see his shoulders were kind of bent forward, caused him to pull that ball, lose his timing.
Boy, could have been picked up.
Right in the pocket.
Yep.
Just a touch high at the end.
Could have evened it.
Larry, this is setting up to be one of those tie situations here. We are within 10 pins back and forth. Hate to see it come down to a team that makes an error.
Yeah.
But it might.
Yep. So good cover by Klug.
Hardington hanging on to that 13-pin lead.
And the cover. Hey, I want to remind you, this is going to be a good one. You're going to want to preserve these memories for a lifetime. Get a DVD of this or any state high school bowling championship or any state high school championship. But specifically bowling, you log on to nhsbf.com. nhsbf.com. Follow the links and the prompts and order your DVD online today. Order one for Grandma and Grandpa, too.
This is coming down to the end, and it is a good one. These teams are back and forth. A little slower.
Oh, got it.
Looks like it might have been a little slow, Larry, compared to the last few shots he's made, but right there. See if Hardington Cedar Catholic can answer.
A shot by Howell. Crosses over.
A little high. Pulled it about 2 boards.
So a big shot here by Sean Ganzebaum. Ganzebaum with a strike can even this up. Needs to get up.
Got a break though, Larry.
Sure
it could have washed out. washout. It would have been the 1-2 and then the 10 in the right-hand corner. Got that 10 to fall, so now it becomes more of a routine spare.
Seth Howell needs this one, lays it down, right at it, got it. Well, very careful was he. Took his time, set up, made sure he was confident with the line, and converted. Now an important spare opportunity here for Ganzebaum.
He's got a hook, it's gonna be okay.
And a good shot. So Ganzebaum converts.
Oh, did he foul, Larry? There was a foul on that shot.
He sure did.
He fouled on
that
shot.
Well, I saw the reaction, and I thought maybe he thought he had missed it. But you're right. He was reacting to his foul.
That's just very unfortunate here. A mark here will put the clamps to things. Oh, man. That's going to be
big turn. Make it now a 20-pin advantage. So imperative for Hubza, Wieland, Dorlog to finish strong down the stretch here for Wayne. Crossover, almost in a must spare situation now for Wayne.
Well, if Hardington can strike here, that's going to give them a 26-pin lead and really set them up to win the state championship here. But if they don't strike, there's still a chance for Wayne.
Buries it.
That's probably the shot of the tournament there for Hardington Cedar Catholic. Just dead flush in the pocket, right up that 7 board. Got to have a spare here to have any chance. Looks like it's going to be covered well.
Good shot by Andrew Walter of Hardington to put that double together, and I think the lead's actually at 40 now. So it puts them through to 47. You're right, Steve. 33-pin advantage right now for Hardington.
This is a state championship shot right here. Strike here for Hardington Cedar Catholic will wrap it up. It's got a chance. Just a
little
touch high. 146 in the 7th for Hardington Cedar Catholic. A spare with a strike working with a spare will give them 166 in the 8th on a 206 clip where Wayne is on about a 174 clip. They've got to start striking right now.
194, the best Wayne can have, and that's if they strike out. So strikes, almost a must, and that will about put the nail in it right there.
Best Wayne can shoot with a spare in the 9th here will be 182. All that's going to need is a mark now in the 10th for Hardington Cedar Catholic.
Maybe not even that now after that spare.
Just some pins. Going to stay behind the foul line.
Yep.
Needs 7 to win. 7 to lock it up. You know, both these teams bowl really well. Boy, you know, I'm not going to tell you that foul in the 7th was a killer, but you look at the Hardington line score, no errors in this game. 4 strikes there. You see it there at double in the 7th and the 8th. It's just tough to beat. They've kept the ball in play.
So Seth Howell, the anchor bowler and senior for Hardington for a state title. That does it.
That's enough.
So Hardington Cedar Catholic with that 9-pin count will take home a state championship. The first ever for Hardington, the co-op of Hardington and Hardington Cedar Catholic, which goes by Hardington Trojans. As we mentioned, all 7 of these bowlers from Cedar Catholic.
It's a victory for the whole town, Larry.
It certainly is.
It's a great sports town up there. And they bowled very well. This was a very well bowled 5 games by them.
Yep.
They did not have very many errors. Just well done. They're going to be at or above 200. Cross lane at the 4. Got to hand it to Corey Dorlog. He's a senior. He was their high average player. Kind of a heartbreak there. Even with that spare in the 7th, they would have been in the 190s, so they wouldn't have been enough with the job that Hardington did. So just good bowling. And ended on a strike there, almost.
So a good finish for the Wayne Blue Devils, shoot 170. in the final game, but congratulations. Great job to come back, keep it close. They were down 1-0, down 2-1. Two teams just trading blows back and forth, but the final salvo was fired by Cedar Catholic, who went without an error in this final game of the Class C State Championship match. It's a clean game, as they say, Steve.
Yes.
And finished off with a strike and a line out. And an excited Hardington Trojan group. The Hardington Trojans, champions in Class C. When we come back, we'll have the trophy presentation, medal presentation, as well as steel chalk for the champs. It's all coming up next on NET Sports.
There's a growing movement towards buying food locally. NET News and Harvest Public Media looks at producing and eating locally grown foods. Find out how farmers, retailers, and consumers are changing their thoughts in home fields, digging into local food.
Tonight at 7:30 Central Time on NET1.
You know, many years ago when I was about 8 years old, I got the opportunity to watch a box turtle behind my house lay her eggs. And watching that turtle go through all that effort, it just piqued my curiosity and I wanted to learn more and read more. My entire job is science. I want children to get connected with science and utilize the technology and the engineering abilities, because each one of us has the ability to change the world.
To find out what you can do to inspire a young person, visit connectamillionminds.com.
Lands an excited Hardington Trojan group as Hardington knocks off Wayne in five, 3-2. Steve Simpek is with some champions.
All right, Larry, thanks. We are here with state champions, the Hardington Public, Hardington Cedar Catholic co-op team here, Coach Jim Anderson. Congratulations. This is your third trip in a row to state and your first state championship. Way to bring it down to 5. What bits of advice are you giving all the boys when they got down and then caught back up and eventually eked it out here?
Just stay calm, pick up their spares. That's what I've told them all year, and that's what they did this week, and here we are.
Well, Larry Putney and I were commenting in the booth that that spare shooting is like defense in football. You have to play good defense to win, and spare shooting is a great defense. Seth, you're the senior. You bear down a couple of great shots there at the end. You seem to be kind of the team leader. What were you telling your teammates?
Just keep your cool and really bear down on them spares, because like you said, it's very important. And just have fun, because that's what we're here to have.
Well, congratulations. Congratulations to our Class C boys champions. Larry, back to you.
All right, thanks very much, Steve. So what a terrific win for the folks from Northeast Nebraska. Both Hardington Public and Hardington Cedar Catholic, they will take home the championship trophy. But another Northeast Nebraska team should be very proud of their performance as well. That is the Wayne Blue Devils. And for those trophy and medal presentations, we go to our public address announcer, Greg Porchy.
Ladies and gentlemen, how about a nice round of applause for our two finalists? And now for the awards presentation. Your Class C boys runner-up, the Wayne Blue Devils, coached by Dusty Baker and Justin Cunningham. Brady Ping. Chris Bird. Corey Dorlag. Dylan Wieland. Keith Hubza. Sean Ganzabon. And Stephen Moore. And here's your runner-up trophy. Congratulations to the Wayne Blue Devils, your Class C boys runner-up. Now, here's your 2011-2012 Class C Boys Champions, the Hardington Trojans. Coached by Jimmy Anderson and Mike Emanuel. Andrew Walter. Connor Weisler. Derek Klug. Eric Cruzy, Ross Wintz, Seth Howell, and Steve Herbelsheimer. And gentlemen, here's your championship trophy. Congratulations to the 2011-2012 Class C Boys Champions.
So congratulations once again to your state champs, the Hardington Trojans in Class C. When we come back, I'll step aside. John Lucido will step in. Steve Simpek will be with you. I'm stepping down to the lanes as the Pius 10 Thunderbolts take on York for the Boys State Championship. Stay with us.
Brought to you in part by the Ellen and Marcia Bear Foundation and by the Nebraska High School Bowling Federation, encouraging high schools to sanction the sport of bowling across Nebraska.
Hey, college doesn't just happen. You have to be a pain, in a good way. Find someone to help you, like your mom, dad, teacher, or coach. Keep asking until you find someone who will. There were adults in my life who made sure I took the right classes in high school, helped me apply for scholarships, and research colleges. Someone will help you, too. You just have to ask. This is the one time it's okay to be a pain.
Next time on POV. Meet three young drivers in the Little League of professional racing.
I said, Daddy, I want to be the first woman to win the Daytona 500.
There she is. Look how beautiful it looks.
Racing dreams, only on POV.
Thursday night at 9 Central Time on NET1.
Hello, I'm Jeff Beckman. If you'd like to see sports action on NET continue into the future and your legacy live on for generations to come, consider arranging an estate gift. Call me directly and I'll explain a number of options available here at Nebraska's home for sports, NET.